Okay, it's the 1st of December. It's almost 6 a.m. And this year I'm trying to record my solutions to the advent of code. Let's see what happens. Let's see how much I will embarrass myself. I don't want to be really competitive. I will just try to solve it, and I will certainly not go to the global leaderboard. I just want to have fun, maybe be a little bit educational, and let's see what happens. Okay, so this is the first problem. Okay, we are given this kind of input, a little bit bigger. Okay, so this is kind of how advent of code works. You get 25 puzzles, one puzzle a day, and each puzzle has two parts, and for each part you solve, you get one star. And this is the first star. Okay. And we are given a map. No. Okay. So our puzzle input is something that has been composed by okay, so we just have lines, and then we are looking for digits in each line. So for example here, 1 and 2. And we're looking for the first digit in each line and the second digit in each line. So 1, 2, 3, 8, 1, 5, and then the 2 is being ignored, and here 7 is both the first and the last digit. And then we should form two digit numbers and add all of them together. All right, so first, let's just copy this into some document, and I have already prepared some place to copy, and oops, yep, that's not what was supposed to happen. Well, let's start again. Okay, then let's see how to handle this input. So I'm gonna do this in Haskell, and whatever you do in Haskell, you have to write in a main function, just like you do in C. First of all, what we're gonna do is we have to read a file, and I have actually prepared some template from last year. And this is how I did this. So basically, this is one of the files I did, one of the problems I solved last year. What I just did, my main function was, I read a file, and I read both the test input file, which was provided on the side, and the main input I was given, and any other persons, they have other inputs. So this is just, if we go back to, oops, nope. If we go back to the advent of code side, here I get my puzzle input, and this is a bit longer, so I actually have to program something. Okay, but here we have we had our test input. Should obviously work for both our test input. For test input, it should give the value 142, and then for the for the actual input, it should give another value, and I should put the value here. All right. So, but first of all, I think it's good practice to make sure that this actually works for the test input file, and just to make sure that I get the right file, and I think it was test.txt. Oops. All right, and then the next thing is when we do this, we get some string, which it's probably not the optimal way to do this runtime wise, but because strings in Haskell are quite inefficient. So let's call this test input. Okay, and then we have to do something with our test input. Namely, we just have to more or less solve the problem, and this is solving the first part. And it's more or less, they call it calibration values, but this is just the story behind it. So here you get some string, and then we have to do something with that. Let's just for now always get give back zero. So more or less test output would be let's just see how I did this last year, because I had some kind of structure in there. So okay, we just gave out this. I can actually copy this probably. Just so. Okay, and then uncomment all of this. All right. So here I don't think we need to pass the input for now. So just we just take some of the calibration values. If the input is a bit more complicated, I actually did some real parsing last year, but now I don't think we need that. So how does this work? So we take our string. We said we just extracted the lines in this string. The lines in the string will give us a list of strings, and for each list of strings, we want to get the calibration value. So for each item in the list, we want to get the calibration value. So what we do is we have a function calibration value, and this time I try to be less verbose. So we map this function to each item of the list. So for each line of our input, we are getting this calibration value, and then we sum all of this. Or if you want, you can also write like this. This is the same. And this is basically it. So how do we get the calibration value from a string? So let's see. So we have to traverse the string from the beginning to the end. If we just traverse it and we get to a digit, then this is our first digit, and for now it will be our last digit, and in the end we can update this last digit. So since we want to traverse this is we could try to to do a fold left. This would be the natural way to traverse something. Obviously, there is a chance that there is no digit in a line, which will not happen for these for the inputs, which are well sanitized. So, but like when we start traversing this list, then we don't have any starting value. So we actually have to do some kind of option typing here if we want to do this properly. In Haskell, this is called maybe. Let me just check the fold left type signature because I'm never able to remember this. So fold left is has the signature BAB, BTAB. So what this means is this is the thing we want to get back. This will be the first and the last digit in the end. Then we have a list of things. In this case, this will be the list of our characters. And here is some kind of accumulator, which has the same type of what we're going to give back. And then we also deal how to update this accumulator by something we get in the list. All right, so we have to write a function of type pair of option of digits to character to pair of option of digit. So this will be our helper function. Right, so I said maybe and the digits are integers. We get a character and we get another maybe int compare. Okay, so let's write this function. So here we say, well, whenever we have nothing, and we get a character, then we have if, and here there must be a function is digit somewhere, C. So if the character is a digit, then we will get back just and then read this C, which is probably not what we want. So we have to make we have to convert this digit into a number. So I guess the way to do this is to say we take the since the ASCII codes of the digits are like consecutive, we just take if C turns out to be zero, then we want zero, we just want the ASCII code of zero. If you have one, then we want the ASCII code of one, which is one more than the ASCII code of zero, and so on. And if we haven't found any digits yet, then we will get nothing. So in this case, the digit we just found is both the first and the last digit. All right, so this will be this, and otherwise we get just nothing. If we haven't found a digit, this is the else case, we still get nothing. And this is, yes, it's possible to formulate this a bit more nicely. Okay. All right. Otherwise, if we have found something here, we will always have found some numbers. So, for example, this. We have always found both the first and the last number. So if we then find a digit, then we do not update the first the first number here, but we update the second number, and we just use the same procedure as we did before. All right. Okay, so this is, I think, how we do this folding here. So what we just do then is we let me again. I think the type mix signature set of fold left says that here we get the initial accumulator, which means we haven't found any digits yet, and then we update by means of our list of characters, and this is called S here in our function here. Let's also give this a type here, and this is maybe int. There is a pass error, which means I might have forgotten an else branch. Oops. Yes. So if we didn't find a digit here, then we obviously have to give back the whatever we started with, and just so that the parser will not complain whenever, like, it's not possible that we get nothing in both, we get nothing in one and just a value in both. So we could actually it's probably let's keep this a bit educational. So it turns out, since we either have both values or no values, then I think it's more reasonable to give this a maybe. I put the maybe outside, so we either have a pair of numbers or we have nothing. And then obviously we have to put the just out also outside here. Delete the parentheses. Do the same here, and then do the same here. Okay. Okay, this is a bit cleaner. What's the problem here? It says that we can actually, since we have two functions and both of them are applied to the same character, we can just say the function is the same as this function. Okay, reasonable. And here we have to actually we have actually not found the calibration value yet. So if we have to form a two-digit number out of the two-digit we hopefully found. So let's code that. So number from digit or something. Number from digits. And then this obviously should not be go to this anymore, but should go to int. So number from digits. Also, let's just also make a proper type signature. So this will be maybe int int. By the way, nothing since we changed the type above. Maybe int int, and it should give back an int. And actually, it probably should give back a maybe int, but we just say number from digits, and I guess nothing. Then we let our program crash for now, or we could give back zero, but there is a risk that we get some bugs which we wouldn't detect otherwise if we don't let our program crash. Okay, if we otherwise have just and then n1, n2, then the way to form a two-digit number would be to take 10 times n1 plus n2. So let's do that. And some calibration values. Again, this should go from list of characters. Nope, this should go from list of string to int. Okay, then let's see if this compiles. It does not. Okay, some calibration values should take okay, what is the problem here? Oh, we do the line thing inside here. So we should delete this. What's the problem here? Maybe we start from the beginning. Okay. I forgot parentheses here. And I should put in another argument here. And we have to import some library for isDigit, and this is in data.char. So we have to import that. And I know that also this function odd is in the same library. Still doesn't compile. There is something wrong here. Okay, so since we did this eta reduce, this is a composition of functions now. I don't know if I have to put parentheses here. Just okay. Computer says no. Okay. Says this is redundant. Pattern matches redundant. Yes, because I changed my type signature. Right. Okay. Now it's compiling without complaining. So let's see what happens. Our test is 142. So let's go to the Advent of Code side. No, this is the input here. So 142 is what we want to get. So we have coded correctly. Now I take my the actual input. And I I put it into another file like this. Oops. I just closed my editor. I should not do this. Okay. Then what we have to do is input file name. Is the file we just created. And then, I don't know, main input is what I called it last year, so let's stick to that. Then we read this file. And we uncomment this, and we have to just do the same stuff to the main input, and this should hopefully compile. Still compiling, and our first result is this. So let's put that into the answer field. Yeah, that's the right answer. Great. Just half an hour. All right. So now we have part two. This is the second star for the day. Your calculation isn't quite right. We also have more digits in our input. Ooh. So 2, 9, 8, 2, 3. That's a bit more tricky. Because then our fold left will not work anymore. Okay, but then we just have to modify our function which gives this calibration values. So we have 2 and 9 here before, but we also have the 7 here, and then we have a 6 here, I guess. So 7, 6 will be the value in the last line. All right. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, and 9. Let's not misspell them. All right, how do we do this then? So what we have to change is that we have to change this function. So we just have now cal helper prime, and then no, well, yeah, I think we have to actually start here. So cal value prime has to be defined, and this is a different way how to get this two-digit number from a string. All right, Then I think we have to spell out the actual fold left. So we cannot use fold left anymore because we can't read each character of the string individually. Instead, we have to also look for the substrings, which have the spelled out numbers. So we can still have a kind of a cal helper, but the cal helper, the helper function has to take care of the whole string here. So first of all, we have to say, well, we have to still deal with this accumulator, so we have to first start with this nothing. So we have to still define some kind of helper function which starts with an accumulator, nothing in this case, and gets our string. Okay. And this function will be recursive. So let's say our function has nothing. So this will be what we started with, and we don't have a digit. But then we can say, well, if we start with like the string one, this will be like it starts with these three characters. And then there is a remainder. So if we start with this, then what we do is, well, first of all, we don't get nothing, so we get we want to just recursively apply this to the rest of the string, but then we know we have found the digit one, so we do this. Okay, this will be a long function. All right, and then what we have to do here is we have to actually continue with the remainder of the string, but since theoretically this E could, for example, be the first letter of the word eight, we have to keep this E here. All right. This will not be the most efficient way to code this. And then we have, well, we have the same for two, and we have the same for three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine. But first of all, let's say if we have nothing left in our calculation, so the base case, this should not happen if we have nothing. So we could say undefined, and we should probably say undefined. Okay. And here I think we, first of all, obviously we cannot say undefined, we have to say nothing. Because of the type signature. So here we have to actually, we have to again, or we should again factor out this just here. Okay. professionals would use a macro here, but I'm not a professional. So let's do it like this. And yep. Okay. 1, 2. Five, and not misspell that. Six, seven, oops, eight, and yeah, this is a nice typing exercise. 9, and then I'm not sure how much I have to. There are not so many digits here, so there is nothing starting with NE, so we could actually just go to E. There is nothing starting with W, and there's just something starting with 1. So 3, there is nothing starting with double E, so we can take the last E here. 4, there is not even anything starting with R, there is nothing starting with UR. And there is nothing starting with OUR, so we can actually go to this. Five, there is something starting with E, not with VE. So we can go to E here. 6, nothing starting with X, nothing starting with IX. So this is just this. 7, there is something starting with N, nothing starting with EN or VEN or EVEN. So we can take the N here. 8, there is a lot starting with T, but nothing starting with HT, GHT or IJHT. So we can start with T here. And 9, we can start with E, I guess. Yes. All right. So, and then we also obviously have to define what to do when we get, when we already have when we already have a digit. This is the case which was relevant for part one and which still applies here. So if we get CR and if is digit C, then I have to put some parentheses here. I already see that. So like this. So then we take our usual, what we did before. And so we basically take this from above here. All right. And obviously, obviously then we have to take the remainder. Like this. Okay, now we have defined what we have when we do nothing. And now we have to do the same stuff again, but for something. Is there we have to define this for just n1, n2. So if we already have found digits. Okay. So, and in this case, we give back the thing already. If we are at the end of the list, we just give back what we found. If we are in the middle of the list, we just update the second digit here. So, oops, that's not right. So the n1 will be untouched. And there is some input error, and that's probably because I again forgot the else case here. And of course we have to do this recursively that now, so we have to do call helper, and we have forgotten the prime here also. Oof. Guess to format this properly, this would be kind of like this. So and here we have to add the we have to recurse, of course. And here we just give back what we got from the beginning. All right. And here I have to put in some list. And then what we have to do is we have to get back to our number from digits function and apply this here. So for from our cal helper function, just as a reminder, that the cal helper function takes maybe int, maybe pair of ints, so this can be either nothing or can be a pair of digits we have found, takes in a string, and in the end we will get the final digits we found. So what we start with is we have no digits found, then we get the digits we found, and then we have to again convert them to a two-digit number. So this will be number from digits. And this is again a function composition, So then we have to actually, when we do this, the new calibration values. So for our part two, then we have to use our new function here, cal value prime, which also takes into account the spelled out digits. And this is more or less what we had to take into account. And I think we got a new test input. So let's just say we get a test input prime, and then we have to read a different file. So we have to have another file here. And we got this test input here. Now we have to sum the calibration values. For our alter test input, but for the actual input, the same input we got for the first part in case of this main thing here. All right, let's see if it compiles. Actually, does not, and this is because I made a typo here, and I have to, let's see. I have to put a capital letter here. And it still doesn't compile because I made another typo here. And I have to put this here, and I have to put it in parentheses. Now it's compiling, and now we can look at our test. The test says 281 for the test, and 281 is actually the value we are supposed to get. So let's just see if this is the right value for part two. And this is the thing we submit. Okay, and it's the right answer. So this means that we solved advent of code for the first day. And I will push the code to GitHub, and then maybe I will be back tomorrow, maybe not at the same time because it's 6 a.m. in the morning and I might be tired. But this was it for the first day, and see you for the next video.